Day? Everything clear as mud? Nobody's flunked the class yet? Oh, not something to joke about, is it? Okay, so one of the things I said I would do with the very first thing would be to show you how to see the pointer on the screen when you go to watch it, okay? So here's how you do it. Go to watch a video. Click on YouTube. There's the video. If you try to watch it in this screen, it ain't going to work. Okay? I'm going to turn the sound off so we don't listen to me twice. Okay? Now, you have to do two things. If you only do one of the two things, you won't see the pointer. If you do both of the two things, you will see the pointer. Here's how you do it. First, go into Settings, and look where it says Quality. Change that to 1080p. Okay? That's one of the two things. The other thing is make it full screen. Doing. Now, you will have, that actually doesn't look like it's 1080p, but that's what it's supposed to be. Yeah, there we go. Okay. You will see then that in full resolution, and you should be able to see the pointer. If you don't do both of those, you won't see the pointer on the screen. Okay? Clear as mud? You guys tired of that already? Okay. Okay. Let's, I can't hear myself here. Is that better? Maybe a little better? Okay. Let's turn our attention then back to buffers and back to weak acids, because that's where we're really going to focus our attention. That's what we're going to talk about today. Okay. So for today's lecture, there's not a lot of figures. There's a couple I'm going to show you. And the other thing I'll tell you is in the first part of this course, that's where we get the calculations. People freak out, oh my God, I can't do biochemistry, et cetera, et cetera. The calculations we're going to do are important, but it's not the whole course. Okay? But understanding the meaning of these calculations and understanding how we use these equations to answer questions about charge and so forth is very important. So that's why we actually start here. All right. Now, last time I introduced you to the idea that weak acids don't completely dissociate. All right? If there's one message you wanted to take from the lecture on Monday, that's what it should be. Weak acids do not completely dissociate, and the amount of dissociation that they do is a function of the pH of the solution in which they reside. Okay? The amount of dissociation that they do, that is the loss of a, when I say dissociation, I'm talking about loss of a proton. The amount of dissociation that they do is a function of the pH in which they reside. Okay? Now, because they don't completely dissociate, they have the ability to give up protons and accept protons. How is that the case? Well, let's look at this equation right here for acetic acid. Okay? This shows the dissociation of acetic acid. There's my pointer. Okay? Acetic acid, if I turn my pointer on, all right, dissociates like that. That means if I take HAC, which is the acid form, and I put it into water, some of those HACs are going to break up into protons plus acetates. Not all of them. Okay? Some of them will. Well, the beauty of this is, let's imagine for the moment that half of them are in the HAC form, and half of them are in the AC minus form. Pretty straightforward to think about. And you might say, oh, well, that means that half of them are in the proton form. No, because the protons are affected by other things in the solution. But we can say that half of them are here, half of them are here, and we want to know, ultimately, maybe how many protons are actually there. Okay? Because things can take away protons, put in protons, etc. But we've got this system that's got, let's say, 500,000 molecules of HAC and 500,000 molecules of AC minus. This solution that I've just described to you has a wonderful property. It can absorb protons if I dump some protons into it, and it can give up some protons if I take protons away from it. So let's say I take 100,000 protons and I dump them into that solution. If there weren't something that could absorb those protons, they would change the pH of the solution fairly drastically. However, I've got something that can soak up protons. It's known as the salt, the AC minus. And when I dump in protons, what happens? AC minus gobbles up protons. That reaction, which looks here, moves to the left. A good number of those protons get gobbled up. Well, when I gobble up protons, what I'm doing is I am controlling the pH, right? Because pH is a measure of the number of free protons that there are there. If something gobbles them up, they're not free anymore. Right? Everybody's with me. Okay. So that's a wonderful quality. Let's imagine I throw into that solution 100,000 sodium hydroxides. The hydroxide, of course, OH, will combine with protons. When it does, it makes water, thus removing protons from the solution. If I drastically remove protons from a solution, the pH is going to change. In fact, it's going to go up. Okay? That's an important consideration. Well, this solution I've just described to you is also able to replace those protons that I just sucked away with sodium hydroxide. Because HAC will now release protons, and this equation will move to the right. Everybody in freshman chemistry was described something called the Chatelier's principle. The Chatelier's principle says that a system that is put under stress will act to relieve that stress. The system I've just described to you is a buffer system. The stress is protons or removal of protons. And this system is responding to either gobble up excess protons that I put in or to replace protons that I take away. A perfect example of Le Chatelier's principle. Understand that? Questions about that? Everybody's afraid to ask a question. 1 year I decided, because everybody was so afraid to ask a question, that they must know the stuff, so we gave them a pop quiz. Oh, there we go. I'm sorry, I'm not making fun of you. Thank you for asking the question. Yes?
The Chatelier's principle, does that only apply to buffer systems, or is
this like... Okay. The Chatelier's principle, does it only apply to buffer systems? The answer is no, it does not. It applies to essentially many, many components of chemistry. That's why it's a principle, and it's very, very broadly applicable to many situations. Buffers is a prime example of where that occurs. Okay. Everybody understand that? If I give a pop quiz right now, I'll get 100%. I see a couple people saying yes. Yes, question right there. Okay. So what is it about the buffer that if I add protons to it, that it reacts with the buffer and not with a protein, for example? To a limited extent, it will react with a protein. Okay? But we'll talk about buffers being sort of magical when they are near a magical pH. The magical pH is the pKa. Okay? We will talk about buffer capacity. One of the problems you saw in the book, problems that I assigned, is an issue of buffer capacity. And one of you, when you get to that problem in the book and you start solving it, things won't make any sense. It won't make any sense at all, because you'll get a negative number that you're taking the logarithm of. You can't take the logarithm of a negative number. What in the hell is up with that? Okay. The reason I put that problem in there is so that people can understand something about capacity. Buffers have a limited capacity. It's not infinite. They can't control pH over a giant range. In fact, what we discover is that buffers are maximally effective if the pH of a solution that they are in is within one pH unit of their pKa. So acetic acid, for example, has a pKa of 4.76. An acetate buffer, which is something that you get from acetic acid, an acetate buffer will be maximally effective between pH 3.76 and pH 5.76, one pH unit below to one pH unit above the pKa. Okay? So that's a very good rule. This one pH unit will pop up in other things as well. Right? Now, because the buffer has great, and come back and answer your question, because the buffer has great abilities to give up protons and absorb protons in that range, it's much more likely those protons are going to associate with the buffer than they are with the protein that we're concerned about. Does that make sense? So that's why buffers are great. That's why buffers are important, because we need to maintain our pH in a very narrow range. If we change the pH of our cells by any significant amount, what happens is we start changing the charges within a protein. And we will see that one of the factors that stabilizes protein structure is charge. If we change the charge, we're going to change the structure. And I've already told you that if we change the structure, we lose the function of a protein. We are 100% dependent upon the proteins in our cell. If we start denaturing the proteins in our cell, we are dead. Buffers are critical. Okay? Buffers are critical. We'll talk later in the term about bicarbonate buffer. Bicarbonate is a buffer system in our bloodstream that helps maintain our blood pH pretty narrowly. Okay? So that's an important buffer that we'll talk about. Okay. So buffers resist changes in pH. It's a good thing when you hear the word buffer, you should think of that. Another thing you should think about when you hear the word buffer is a buffer will always, underline always, have a salt and a weak acid. The weak acid, as I noted last time, will always have one more proton than the salt. In this acetic acid buffer, for example, and by the way, I call it an acetic acid buffer. You can also call it an acetate buffer in their equivalent terms. In this acetic acid buffer, there, HAC, is the weak acid because it has one more proton than the salt, which is over here. Okay? Notice I didn't use the word base, and you're not going to use the word base unless we're talking about a strong base. We don't have to worry about what a conjugate acid or a conjugate base or any of that is. We talk about a weak acid and we talk about a salt. Those terms are very simple. Question back here. Yes, where are you? Back there. Okay. Yeah. Right here, you're talking about? So let me ask, what I'm going to do is I usually like to try to repeat the questions for a couple of reasons. One is when you're watching the video, it makes sense. And two, for the people on eCampus who ultimately will be watching these videos, it makes sense as well. So if I forget to repeat the question, always remind me, and I'll try to remember to do that. So the question was, if I put protons in here and AC minus starts gobbling them up, isn't this going to make this unequal? Is that safe to say? Okay. Now, let's get one very important concept in our heads. Equilibrium has nothing whatsoever to do with the word equal. Get it out of your heads. It's not, there's nothing having to do with equilibrium and equal. If you associate those two words, you're going to have trouble. Okay? Equilibrium simply means stable, unchanging. Now, if I started, to come back to answer your question, if I started with an equal amount of AC minus as I did with HAC, which was the way I started, and I dump in protons, will I have equal amounts of AC minus and HAC after I've added those protons? How many say yes?
No.
There's a no. All right. I like that. Good. The answer is no. Okay? We will not have equal amounts of protons because what's going to happen? Every time an AC minus grabs a proton, what happens to it? It becomes HAC. Right? So if I started with 500,000 HACs and 500,000 AC minuses, I'm going to have 400,000 AC minuses when I'm done and 600,000 HACs because I converted 100,000 of them into HAC. Make sense? Now, that's a very important concept, and I'm glad you asked the question. It's a very important concept because it shows how we can change the relative amounts of salt and acid by adding protons, by removing protons, right? So I started in the example I gave with equal amounts, but I didn't end up with equal amounts, right? Well, let's do some math, and we're going to do simple math, all right? Going to do math. Let's say we start with that solution where I had equal amounts, and let's run it through the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. By the way, you will not have to memorize any equation in this class. I will give you every equation you will need. Okay? No equations necessary to memorize. No calculations necessary to do. Wow. Now it's sounding better and better, right? All right. Let's run this through the Henderson-Hasselbalch. pH equals pKa plus the log of salt over acid, right? Where's my Henderson-Hasselbalch? Here we go. Okay? I say, what's the pH of that solution where I had equal amounts of those two? Well, the pKa for acetic acid is 4.76. And by the way, the pKa for a weak acid is a constant. It always is that same value for that given weak acid. When I talk about acetic acid, it will always be 4.76. And yes, if you need that information, I will give you that information. Okay? So 4.76 is the pKa. The log of the concentration of salt to acid is really the function of how many of each one of those there is, right? So if I had 500,000 AC minuses and I had 500,000 HACs, I would have 500,000 divided by 500,000, which would be equal to, and what is the log of 1? 0. Did you need to memorize that? I'll put that on the exam for you, too. Okay? Getting easier and easier, right? All right. So the pH then is equal to the pKa plus 0. I think people could pretty well figure out without a calculator that the pH under that condition is equal to the pKa. Right? So in that case, the pH would be 4.76. Let's imagine that I took that solution that I had the 500,000 and the 500,000, and I added 100,000 protons to that mixture. And I say, what's the pH of that solution? Okay. Well, again, I'm in a weak acid. And in this weak acid, I have to use the Henderson-Hasselbalch. And so I come up with the pH, which is equal to the pKa, which is 4.76, plus the log of AC minus divided by HAC. But I no longer have 500,000 divided by 500,000. I have 400,000 AC minuses. And I have 600,000 HACs, right? You said we weren't going to have to use a calculator. If you wrote your answer on the exam as pH equals 4.76 plus the log of 400,000 divided by 600,000, you just got the answer. 100%. Was that complicated? If I said to you at that point, is the pH higher or lower than the pKa, what would you tell me? How many say higher? How many say lower? How many don't say anything? I can't expect them to raise their hands because they're not going to, right? All right. It's going to be lower. How do I know it's lower? Because 400,000 divided by 600,000 is the same as 4 divided by 6. And 4 divided by 6 is less than 1. Right? And the log of a number less than 1 is always negative. And yes, I will tell you that on an exam as well. So, the pH, therefore, is equal to 4.76 plus a negative number. Therefore, the pH is lower than 4.76. Make sense? You can do these. These are practical mathematics. These are practical chemistry. Okay? You're actually understanding a system and not punching numbers in a calculator. Yes, sir? We will, yes, the salt will gobble up the protons that we've added. That's correct. Well, there's, for our purposes, they will essentially gobble up all the protons that we've added. That's correct. Okay? So now you've got a very powerful tool to start to understand what happens to pH when I add protons or subtract protons. Or I can even tell what happened to a solution if I know its pH. How do I do that? Well, let's say I told you that I had a solution, and I'll come back to your question in just a second. Let's say I had a solution of acetic acid, and I told you that the pH was 5. And I said to you, are there more AC minuses or HACs there? Well, we plug it in. We say 5 equals 4.76 plus blah, blah, blah. We take 4.76 to the side, and we discover that 0.24 equals the log. Is 0.24 a positive number or a negative number? It's a positive number. That means that this ratio must be greater than 1, which means, therefore, I must have more AC minus than I have HAC. That's the kind of thing I expect that you will be able to do. If you have difficulty with that, come see me. I'll be happy to help you. The TAs will as well. Question over here. If you had 10 AC minuses and you added 10 protons, would you assume that you had 10 HACs? When we start to push the limits of a buffer, which is what we're doing here, there are other considerations. I'm keeping it very simple for you, and you will not have to work equations like that. How's that? Unless you want to go through it. What does it mean to say buffers resist change in pH when it's in the buffer region? Very good question, because I say that in my notes. Right? There's a problem, one of the problems that I put on here. Let me see if I can find it. I don't have the problems like they do. Hold on. I've got the problem-solving videos, but I don't have the problems linked. So there's a problem that I work in the problem-solving videos over here that illustrates this principle to you. And I'll just tell you in words to answer your question. But I'll post the problems later, OK? So what does it mean to say a buffer resists change in pH? Okay. If I have a solution of water, pure water, no buffer, nothing else, and I add, let's say I've got 1 liter of water, and I add 0.1 moles of protons. Let's make it simple. Let's make it 0.01 moles of protons. Okay? That pH is going to go from being 7, which is what pure water is, down to 2. Okay? That's a change of 5 pH units. If I have a buffer that is, let's say, 0.1 molar, and I add that same number of protons, let's say I have an acetic acid buffer, and it starts out at, let's say, 4.76, just to make it simple, and I add that same number of protons, what I will discover is that the pH will drop by about 0.1 pH units. Instead of falling 5 pH units in no buffer, When I had it in that acetic acid buffer, it fell by 0.1 pH units. That's what I mean by saying the buffer resists change in pH. Make sense? Okay. So when I'm in that buffering region, as long as I don't exceed the capacity of my buffer, I'm in good shape. How do I exceed the capacity of my buffer? Okay. How do I exceed the capacity of my buffer? I exceed the capacity of my buffer by adding more protons than I have things that can take them up. Or by taking away more protons than I can replace. So if I have a buffer that is, let's say, one of the problems that's in the book is you have a buffer that's got about 0.1 molar acetic acid. Sodium acetate, so it's all salt. 0.1 molar salt. If I add 0.5 moles of protons, there's no way that 0.1 moles of salt can absorb 0.5 moles of protons. I will have exceeded the capacity. The capacity, the absolute maximum capacity that that buffer has is 0.1 moles of protons because each salt can absorb one proton. So if I dump 0.5 moles of protons in there, I've blown it out of the water. I no longer have a buffering solution. You're going to see that in a problem that you're going to work. It's problem 18 in the book. Okay? So don't be surprised if things don't make sense when you get to that point. And the good news is I won't ask you to calculate the pH of that solution if you exceed buffering capacity. I won't ask you. Okay? But I give you that problem so that you can see that, yeah, it's not a buffer anymore. The pH goes boing. Okay? Now, there was one other thing I wanted to say about a buffer that I want everybody to get in their head. And I talk about this until I'm blue in the face. I talk about a lot of things until I'm blue in the face. I probably would really actually be blue in the face if I did that as much as I said I did. But I talk about this a lot. Okay? When you hear the word buffer, I want you to always, always, always think weak acid and salt. I've mentioned that before. But if I said that, if I told you that I have a buffer that is a 0.2 molar acetate buffer, let's say I've got 1 liter of it, that means that the salt plus the acid is going to add up to that 0.2 molar concentration. So when you hear buffer, think salt and weak acid. Okay? That's really, really critical. When you hear the word buffer, think buffer equals salt plus weak acid. Okay. Now, I'm going to stop there and ask for questions. Yeah, question. Yep. If I had a 0.2 molar acetate solution, how would I decide how much salt was in there? If all I told you that I had a 0.2 molar acetate solution, there would be no way on earth for you to determine that. No way. Why? Okay. Well, let's look at this solution. Let's look at this problem. Here's the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Okay. I've got 0.2 molar acetate buffer, but I don't know how much acid and salt that I have. Further, I don't know the pH. I don't know the pH. So without that information, I've got one equation and I've got three unknowns. I can solve equations that have one equation, one unknown. I can't solve an equation that has one equation, two unknowns. And I certainly can't solve an equation where I have one equation and three unknowns. Okay. If I told you that the pH of that solution, okay, was 5, you could solve it. Okay. You could solve it. How would I solve? Well, in this case, I'm assuming that the buffer is 0.2 molar, and buffer equals acid plus salt. So one of my equations is acid plus salt equals 0.2. The other equation is the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Now I have two equations, two unknowns. I can always solve an equation like that. Make sense? Yes, back in the back. Okay, so his question is, can I set this equal to x squared over this and get this pH? Based on the way he said the problem, no. If I said I had a solution of acetic acid, okay, he said I had an acetate buffer. So there's a difference. Okay? So one of the problems actually asks you to calculate the pH of a solution where you dump this weak acid in there. And there's a way to solve that. It's actually a quadratic equation. I didn't mean to give you that problem. If you work that problem, that's great. If you don't work that problem, don't sweat it. I think it's number 6. Okay? 6 or 8, I can't remember. All right. I'm going to move on to other things if there's no other questions. Other questions? Okay. Well, let's take, everybody says they're visual learners, right? So I'm up here talking. I'm not giving you anything visual to learn from. Let's look at this visually and understand what this means. And by the way, if you feel that you're a visual learner, a lot of people really feel this, then graphs should make great sense to you. So I'm going to show you a buffer plot. The high-quality graphics were created by yours truly. This is copyright Kevin Ahern, right? And it shows a plot. How many people had to do titrations when they were in freshman chemistry? How much did you learn from those?
A lot.
A lot. Good. I think there's some dissent on that matter, okay? Some people learned a lot. Some people think the person who learned a lot's a liar, but that's another matter. So, okay. I'll let you guys duke it out later. All right. This is a very common plot, all right? And it shows the pH of a solution as a function of the amount of sodium hydroxide that I added to a solution. So this is a very simple kind of buffer. We will discover that amino acids are a little bit more complicated because amino acids have always got at least two weak acids within them. We're only talking about one so far. Here's what happens. This could be, it's not acetic acid because it's not 4.76, but this could be a buffer that has a fairly low pKa. What does a fairly low pKa tell you? It's a stronger weak acid. So here's the pKa value right here. And you can see this pKa value is about 2.5. And that would mean that this weak acid is a stronger weak acid than acetic acid is, because acetic acid has a pKa of 4.76. Okay? This weak acid starts out, we have a solution that starts out, and I usually start buffer problems with all of the protons on a weak acid on, meaning it has to be a low pH. So we start out with this solution of this acid at a very low pH. I started out at pH 0. That's a very low pH. Okay? And then I start adding protons to that solution. I'm sorry, I start adding hydroxides to that solution, so I take away protons. Right? Hydroxides will take away protons. Well, no surprise, when I add hydroxides are part of a strong base. When I add a strong base to a solution, what's going to happen to the pH? The pH is going to rise. We see the pH start to rise, and in fact, we see at the beginning the pH starts to rise fairly steeply. I thought you said a buffer worked to resist change in pH. They do within a pH unit of the pKa. 0 is not within a pH unit of 2.5. Down here, there's very little buffering. So therefore, a tiny amount of sodium hydroxide caused the pH to jump by a pH unit. Only when I get to within about a pH unit away from the pKa do I see this line start to flatten out, meaning I'm adding a lot more hydroxide, but the pH is only going up a tiny amount. Buffer. I'm adding a lot of hydroxide to the system. The pH is changing very little from about right here up to about right here. This right here between 1.5 and 3.5 is the buffering region. You'll notice if you look at this curve that the flattest part of the curve, that is the least change in pH, occurs right at the pKa. And you remember that the pKa was when we had equal amounts of salt and acid. That's not surprising, because it's at that point the buffer has the maximum ability to hold on to protons. It also has the maximum ability to let go of protons. So at the pKa, we see the flattest region of the buffer. And then we get up here, and we see the pH starting going bonkers up here. Because why? Because we've exceeded the capacity of our buffer, and now we're just adding this to water. And adding hydroxide to water is going to change the pH drastically, just like the example I told you about where I added the protons to the water and we saw it fall 5 units. In this case, it's rising rapidly because I'm adding hydroxides, taking away protons. Now, this is a very interesting and cool concept. Acetic acid is a simple weak acid. It's simple because it only has one part of it that can give up protons or accept protons. That's the AC part of it. Amino acids, as we will discover, have two parts of them that can give up or accept protons. One part is the carboxyl group, and one part is the amine group. It's the carboxyl group that gives it the acid part of its name, and it's the amine group that gives it the amino part of its name. Okay? That means that every amino acid, okay, is a weak acid in two ways. And here's the cool thing. Each of those groups, that is the carboxyl and the amine, each of those groups has their own unique pKa value. Each has their own unique pKa value. The pKa for a carboxyl group in an amino acid, that is called something we'll describe later as the alpha carboxyl, the alpha carboxyl group in an amino acid has a pKa value typically about 2.2. The alpha amine, which we'll talk about later, which is the other group, typically has a pKa value around 9. Why am I telling you this? I'm wanting you to imagine what the buffer plot for an amino acid would look like. Who would like to tell me? Okay, so when you say plateau, you're talking about the flattening? Exactly. Okay. So this guy that I just described to you is going to have, it's going to go up, it's going to flatten out around 2.2, it's going to take off again, and it's going to flatten out around 9. Okay? You just earned 1 point of extra credit on the first exam. So tell me after class your name, and I'll make sure you get it. Okay? Oh, yeah, it helps to talk in class, doesn't it? Okay? Everybody understand that? So you could look, I could show you a plot, and you'd say, oh, wow, it's got two different flattening regions, therefore it must have two groups that can gain and lose protons. Bingo. If I showed you one that had three, I think you could pretty quickly figure out, hey, it's got three regions. If I showed you one that had 10, you can start doing the math and start figuring out how many it would take. It'd be 10 of them, right? So this is cool. This very simple plot tells us a lot about a buffer system. Okay. If I went to this point right here and I put that dot there where my pointer is, and I said, "Are we in a buffering region?" I think all of you would agree we're not in a buffering region. We're not within one pH unit. We're also in a region where the pH is rising very rapidly, even though we're only adding a tiny amount of hydroxide. Okay? A lot of things you can get from this. Now, one of the things you'll see in this class is when we work with graphs, if I were to ask you to draw a buffer plot on an exam, the first thing that's going to come to your mind is the shape. Okay? And that's not all the information that we need to understand that. Okay? Buffer plots, or any plot, must have axes labeled. Because what if I put equivalence of OH over here and I put pH down here? Do you suppose it would look the same way? No. Okay. So, if you just simply draw shapes on a piece of paper, you're going to get it wrong because you have to label the axes. It's very important to make sure when you do plots or graphs in this class that you label axes. Okay? All right. Now, questions about that? Everybody's tired, right? Yes, question. Say it again. Yep.
So if you're in a molecule, then how does that higher pH not affect the other part?
Okay, I think I understand your question. So the question is, you've got an amino acid that's got a flattening here and it's got a flattening up here at 9. How does the flattening up here at 9 not affect the thing down here? I think that's what you're asking about. Okay, so the question really is, if I have a solution that has a pKa here down at 2.2 and another one that has a pKa at 9, the other way to ask this question is, which group is going to accept or give up protons? That's really your question, right? Because you're saying, how does one influence the other? And the answer is, the one that's doing the absorbing or giving up protons is going to be the one that is at the pH the solution is at. So if I were to be in this solution and I were to be at pH 3 and I said which group is giving up or accepting protons, you would say it would be this one because that's within one pH unit of that pKa. This one will not, the one at the higher pKa will not enter into the equation in any significant way. Is that what you're asking? Okay. And this is an important thing to keep in mind. They don't really influence each other as such. But they will be active or inactive depending upon the pH in which they're found. Okay? Very good question. You guys ready for a song? Okay.
Yes, let's have a song.
Oh, the limerick. I'm sorry. The limerick for the day. I should give you the limerick. Sorry about that. I did put it up here. I didn't show it to you. The limerick for today. So the happily beaming transistor, as he reached for the diode and kissed her, my passion enlarges for all of her charges. There is no way I can resist her. How's that? All right, here's the song. The song of the day is one you may relate to after what we've been going through so far. It's called Biochemistry, Biochemistry.
Biochemistry, biochemistry, I wish that I were wiser. I feel I'm in way o'er my head. I need a new advisor. My courses really shouldn't be such metabolic misery. Biochemistry, biochemistry, I wish that I were wiser. Biochemistry, biochemistry, reactions make me shiver. They're in my heart and in my lungs. They're even in my liver. I promise I would not complain if I could store them in my brain. Biochemistry, biochemistry, I wish that I were wiser. Biochemistry, biochemistry, I'm truly in a panic. The mechanisms murder me. I should have learned organic. For all I have to memorize, I ought to win the Nobel Prize. Biochemistry, biochemistry, I wish that I were wiser.
All right, see you guys on Friday.